In my previous video on the IBM PC XT, we didn't go into much detail of the machine itself. Instead, we were focusing on diagnosing an issue that prevented the PC from starting. So we ended up finding the culprit, fixing the issue at hand, and getting the machine to boot again. So now that we have the machine completely up and running again, I thought it would be interesting to go into a little bit more detail on the machine itself and all of the internal components that make up this IBM PC XT. Now, the IBM PC XT, or 5160, released in March of 1983, roughly 1 year and a half after the original IBM PC, released in 1981. It's actually just a minor upgrade of the original IBM PC, the 5150. Sure, it has a hard disk now of 10 megabytes, but in the end, it's the same processor. When it was released, it had a little bit more memory than the original PC, although both versions max out at 640 kilobytes. It does come with 3 additional expansion slots, but all in all, it's a minor upgrade. So on the front, we have the beautiful IBM Personal Computer XT badge, a 5 1/4 inch floppy drive, 360 kilobyte, and the 10 megabyte hard drive. On the back, we find our usual suspects. From left to right, we have the power supply with both an input and an output for the monitor. We have a keyboard connector. We don't have the cassette port connector. And we have our expansion cards that we'll look into more detail now. After opening her up, we have the power supply, expansion cards and mainboard, disk drive and hard drive. That's pretty much it. Now, to remove the floppy drive and the hard drive, we need to flip the case around. And here at the bottom, we find this hole where we have 2 screws that hold the floppy drive and the hard drive in place. So we'll need to unscrew these first before we can actually slide them out. Next up, it's just a matter of removing these 2 screws on the side, and the hard drive should come right out. Now, this is a full-height Seagate ST412 hard drive, a 10 megabyte hard drive that came as standard on these IBM 5160s. Okay, to remove the floppy drive, we need to unscrew these 2 screws here at the side, but in order to do that, we need to remove all of the expansion cards first. So let's get started with that. We have our video card, memory expansion card, and real-time clock. A fixed disk controller for the hard drive. A floppy drive controller for our 5 1/4 inch floppy drive. And our final card tucked away behind the floppy drive is our async card, offering 1 serial port. So with all of those out of the way, we can finally reach the 2 screws that hold the floppy drive in place. So we'll go ahead and unscrew those, so that we can slide out our floppy drive. Before we can remove the mainboard, we'll disconnect the PC speaker, and then we can slide out the mainboard out of the chassis so that we can take a closer look at the actual mainboard. And here we have it. All of the components that make up an IBM 5160 completely disassembled. And now let's take a closer look. So we have the main board, we have the floppy drive, hard drive, both full height devices. We have our floppy drive controller, we have our video card, our memory expansion card, fixed disk controller for the hard drive, our async card, and the beautiful Model F keyboard. Although this one needs a little bit of cleaning. But let's start by looking at the main board. This is the 256 kilobyte version. The very first 5160 only had 64 kilobytes of memory. That was later upgraded to 128 by default, and later on to 256. A second revision of the mainboard allowed you to max out the onboard memory to 640 kilobytes. Although on this particular mainboard, an IBM supported hack, so to speak, is also possible to allow you to have 640K in the four memory banks of this motherboard. It features an AMD 8088 CPU running at 4.77 MHz with an optional math coprocessor. We have two BIOS chips that make up the BIOS for this IBM PC XT, one Motorola and one IBM label chip. We have eight expansion slots, all 8-bit ISA slots, with slot 8 being a special one, the one closest to the CPU. We have four memory banks containing eight chips each and one additional parity chip. So there is 256 kilobytes of memory on this board. Although there are two BIOS chips, there's no CMOS included, so everything is configured using these DIP switches. So there are eight switches, each with a different function. So the first one needs to be turned off in order for the PC to operate normally. The second one needs to be turned on if we don't have the math coprocessor. Switches 3 and 4 control the number of banks which are enabled. So we've enabled all banks. So in our case, switch 3 and 4 are switched off. 5 and 6 indicate the different types of video cards that are supported by the PC. Given that we have a Hercules card, switches 5 and 6 are turned off. And switches 7 and 8 allow you to configure the number of floppy drives that need to be present in the PC. So as we only have one drive, both of the switches are turned on. Moving along, we have a standard XT keyboard connector, and we don't have the cassette port interface on this one. And we have a header to attach our PC speaker. Now, upon introduction, the IBM XT had two available graphic card options. It had the IBM monochrome display adapter, can be seen on the left here, and the IBM color graphics adapter, or CGA adapter, seen on the right. However, shortly after the introduction of the IBM XT, the Hercules graphics adapter became very popular and lots of aftermarket options became available in terms of graphics. So this video card is a Hercules graphics clone built around the Tomahawk TD3088A GPU chip. It has 64 kilobytes of RAM and can be hooked up to a standard IBM MDA monochrome monitor like the IBM 5151. Next up, we have the IBM Asynchronous Communication Adapter, a very small card that adds an RS-232 serial port to the system. It can be configured as the primary or secondary adapter, depending on the fact if another serial port is already present. This is a special card that can be used in slot 8 of the mainboard, so it has a special jumper to enable its functioning in slot 8 of the mainboard. Next up, we have the IBM 5¼-inch disk drive adapter, a card made by IBM. So only one of these cards can be fitted in the system, and it supports up to four floppy drives, two internal floppy drives and two external floppy drives. It supports 360 kilobyte floppy drives, so double density. And on my IBM PC XT, as many others, it is paired with this beautiful Tandon TM102A double density, full height, 5¼-inch floppy drive supporting 360 kilobytes floppies. I think these are just awesome to look at. They're a wonderful piece of engineering. There's lots of stuff going on this PCB here, lots of components, lots of connectors. It's full height. Here you can see the fix that we did on the floppy drive in order to get it working again. It's just a wonderful piece of equipment. The Tandon TM102A, built in 1985. Next up, we move to another official IBM expansion card, the IBM Fixed Disk Controller, used to hook up a hard drive to the system. Now, this is a second revision expansion card, but still it only supports one single drive that has very specific characteristics, meaning that it only supports a 10 megabyte hard drive with 306 cylinders, 4 heads, and 17 sectors. This is sometimes referred to as a single geometry controller. So here we have the connectors to hook up the MFM hard drive. And there's no external connectors. And what's interesting to note here is that the controller lacks the switch block that later revisions of this controller have, allowing you to configure different hard drives. So with this card, you're limited to one hard drive and one specific hard drive, which is this one, the Seagate ST412. Now, this is a 10 megabyte MFM hard drive, full height, IBM branded, and it's the official hard drive that came with the IBM PC XT. So this is, as a side note, this is also the hard drive that is identified as type 1. You probably remember those BIOS settings from 286, 386, or 486 computers where you could specify a hard drive type. Now, most of us used the user type 47, but this hard drive was actually type number 1. So much like the floppy drive, this hard drive, there's lots of stuff going on the PCB here, lots of components. Again, a beautiful piece of engineering. Full height, really big, really loud. But it still works, so it's really nice to see these things still coming back to life after 30 years or something. Next up, we have the six-pack card. Now, this is a card that does a lot of different things. It's primarily used as a memory expansion, but it has some other things going for it as well. So on the left, you see that there are lots of chips here. So this is the memory section. We have six banks of memory here. This card is fully populated, but it doesn't need to be. You can configure the card using DIP switches, where you specify the number of banks which are installed on the 6-pack plus and where it needs to start its memory address. Now, the starting address will be determined by a couple of things. The amount of memory you have on your mainboard, which can be anywhere from 64 to 256, or any other memory expansion cards that might be in the system. Now, keep in mind in general that an IBM XT cannot address more than 640 kilobytes of RAM. So every bank is equipped with 8 chips, including one parity chip. Each chip is 8 kilobytes. Each bank is 64 kilobytes. So this gives us a total of 384 kilobytes on this card. So adding that to our maxed out mainboard that contains 256 kilobytes of RAM, we get a total of 640 kilobytes of RAM. But if that wasn't enough, the card also contains this coin cell and a real-time clock, allowing you to persist your date and time settings between shutdowns of the PC. It also includes this game port connector, allowing you to add joysticks. It comes with a parallel port connector, so you can hook up parallel devices. So let's put everything back together. We'll start with the hard drive that will slide into the slot. You need to take into account that there is not a lot of room between the hard drive and the power supply, so you'll need to attach the cables before you slide the hard drive all the way to the back. We also attach the power cable to the hard drive. As you can see here, it's pretty cramped up there. Next up is our floppy drive, so we just slide it in and we will fasten the two screws on the side and later at the bottom. Again, it's pretty cramped at the back, so there's not a lot of room between the power supply and the floppy drive, so it's best to insert the cables before. The drive also needs power, obviously, so we'll go ahead and attach that. And now we can start inserting our expansion cards again. Now, there is a recommended order of inserting the cards. Most of them are based on the length of the case and the length of the cards, but also the slot 8, which is the first slot, which is kind of a special slot, so only a number of cards will actually work in this slot. So we start with our async card, the serial port that we put into slot 8. So this is one of the few cards that actually work in slot 8. Next up is the IBM 5 1/4 inch disk drive adapter that we will connect to our tandem floppy drive using this ribbon cable. Now there are three ribbon cables that we need to attach to our fixed disk adapter. So we'll do that here. So again, it's a very tight fit. The cables are just long enough to facilitate adding them to this fixed disk controller. And it's the closest slot that we can use. So yeah, it's all very tight up here. So this being a full length card, we can use the little rails which are on the front of the chassis. Next up is our 6-pack plus memory expansion, real-time clock, parallel port, game port. Again, a full length card that takes up the entire case. And we finish off with our Hercules clone, a very small card, but if this would have been a IBM color graphics adapter or a monochrome display adapter, it would have also been a full length card. But everything is hooked up now. It's time to put the cover back on and see if she will still start. So we slide the cover over these rails on the chassis. We need to give it a little nudge here so that it goes over the back so that we can fit in the screws at the back. So thanks a lot for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this little overview of the IBM PC XT. I have two more videos planned surrounding this PC. One is looking at what kind of software we can run on it, and another is a comparison with its older brother, the IBM 5150. So please stay tuned. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, consider subscribing, share the video, and I'll see you soon. Bye-bye.